Welcome to those who have joined us for the front porch. This is informal time when we can't, maybe you've got a snack, your coffee, your drink. Enjoy those things. You can choose to be on camera, off camera. Either one's fine, but we welcome you to the space. We're just going to kind of hang out here for a little bit, imagining that if we were gathered at a conference, we would all be maybe on a front porch somewhere, and we would maybe be sitting in rocking chairs, or we might be gathered standing around waiting for the doors to open. So this informal time is a time for us to kind of do that in a Zoom setting. So one thing I was thinking that might be nice for everybody is to name, to put your pronouns in your name. So I'm going to guide you through the steps of renaming yourself on Zoom. If you scroll over your own picture, you'll see three dots, and then you'll click on the three dots. It says rename, and you can put the name you'd like to go by, and then you can put your pronouns. And another kind of exploratory thing that might be fun for folks, if you'd like to, is to put the native land that you are on at this moment, and then perhaps also like what people commonly know that land to be. So for example, mine right now says Helms, she, her, but I'm going to go and I'm going to click those three dots and I'm going to press rename. And then I'm going to add that I am on Catawba land. And I'm going to add that that's Charlotte, North Carolina. Now, when you're looking at this in your own Zoom, you won't be able to see all of those, that information, unless you kind of scroll over it and look. And you can also press the participants area, and that gives you a little bit more information. So maybe kind of practice that for a minute and add your pronouns to your name and the place that you are in that is known by the native folk, and then the place that you're in that is known more commonly. So that's just one way that we'll be able to introduce ourselves to each other. Since it's totally informal, at any point, if anybody wants to unmute themselves and talk, you're welcome to do that. And I did think it would be nice when we have a smaller group like right now for us to just take some turns to pass the mic to somebody and ask them to introduce themselves, name, pronoun, native land, if you know it, and where you're from. So again, I'm Helms, she, her pronouns, Catawba. I reside on Catawba land, an uninvited guest, but here anyway. And I live in Charlotte, North Carolina. And I'm going to please pass it to Anthony.
Anthony Smith, he, him. And I'm also on Catawba land. We actually have a college here in our city called Catawba College. I'm in Salisbury, North Carolina, and my ancestors were not asked to be here. They were forced to be here. From what ancestry that I do know, yeah.
And Anthony, who would you like to pass it to?
Oh, yeah. Thank you. I'll pass it to Celia.
Celia, if you'll be sure to unmute yourself when you're talking. Perfect. We can hear you now.
Okay. Well, I've tried to figure out what land I'm from.
Good. That's great.
I didn't quite get that. I am newly moved to St. Louis, Missouri. So it could be Archland. It could be Westland. It could be who knows? right now, it's pretty much COVID land.
Well, that is true too. My husband, who spent quite a bit of time in St. Louis, said that it's, what did you say? Cahokia land.
Cahokia land. Yeah. Okay. Sure. Are the Mound City at St. Louis used to be called the Mound City?
Yeah. There you go.
I just left there in February. I was there for 4 years. So hi, St.
Louis. Oh, really? Well, I just moved here in November. I had lived in St. Louis before. I never lived in the St. Louis area. I now live on the ninth floor of a 100-year-old apartment building in a senior apartment building, right across from Tower Grove Parks, which is a wonderful place to be. And I just want to say that I listened last night and watched again Reverend Lanise's presentation, and I was awestruck. I was absolutely awestruck. Her presentation just had so much in it that opened my mind. And I've sort of been on a quest since COVID started, and then especially since the violence has towards Black, especially Black men, has been so much in the news, and have been trying to catch up on what racism is today. I, for many years, worked with a group of white women who worked in their community to try to bridge some of the racism in St. Louis. And I have been so busy. I just fell in love with my grandmother's hands. I had never understood so much of that. And I almost understand police officers now.
And Miss Celia, thank you so much for sharing. We love this. We want to make sure that we're passing the mic. We want to know who else is here. So we'd love to hear more of your story. We're also going to do this at the end. So if you stick around with us.
That's good. Yes. All right. Thank you.
Who else would you like to pass it off to?
Oh, I would like to pass it off to Chelsea.
Hey everybody, I'm Chelsea, she, her. I'm in Durham, North Carolina, raised, yes. Long family history in Durham, and home to the Eno and Okanichi Native tribes.
Welcome, welcome. Chelsea, who would you like to pass it to?
I will pass it to... has Terrence gone?
He hasn't. Go for it, Terrence.
Hey, what's up, everybody? I'm Terrence from Winston-Salem, North Carolina. Excuse me, I got a fan going on in the background. It's just been really dope to build with everybody this weekend. Looking forward to everything that the day has for us. Who do I just pass it to whoever?
Yep.
Okay. I don't know who's gone because I had to hop off.
I'll just pass it for you. Is that okay, Terrence?
Thank you. Thank you.
All right. How about Brandon?
Hey, what's up, y'all? Brandon. I'm in Greensboro, he, him. And I am on Eno. I wrote them down in my profile picture. Eno, Saponi, and Shikori land. And I will pass it to Camila. Or Camila. I hope I'm saying your name right.
Camila, you said it right first. Greetings. I'm over here doing like five things at one time. I apologize. I am Camila Hall Sharp. My pronouns are she and her. I was trying to look up the correct land that I am on. I am currently in Dallas, Texas. I used to live in St. Louis. I'm born and raised in St. Louis when Celia was talking about that. And somebody just, who are the ancestors behind me? I have none other than the Audre Lorde and Maya Angelou, two of my sheroes who got me on this journey. I still don't know the land, so I'm gonna try to find that up and fix that on my thing. I will call Lindsay. I believe she.
I don't see that person's name.
I'm sorry, Lanice.
Thank you.
I don't have on glasses. I apologize.
No, my name is Lanice Pinkard, and I am, pronouns are she, her, and I moved here recently. Well, when I was in California, I was on Ohlone land. The entire state is Ohlone land, and now I'm on Eno and Saponi land, and I'm here in Eflin, North Carolina. And shout out to folks from St. Louis. I grew up in St. Louis. I wasn't born there, but I grew up in St. Louis.
St. Louis has produced some beautiful people, my goodness. Who would you like to pass it off to?
Oh, I'm so sorry. Benikia.
Hey, y'all. Benikia Williams, she, her pronouns. And as of March of this year, I am on Muskogee land, which is the Atlanta, Georgia area. So glad to be here with you all. Let's pass it off to Simone. How you doing?
Hey y'all, I'm Simone. She and they are both fine pronouns wise, and I'm on Ohlone land in California and on Kamehameha territory in San Diego.
Okay.
Sorry, I will pass it off to Whitney. Have you gone?
I haven't gone yet, I'll go. Hey y'all, I'm Whitney. Pronouns she, her, hers. I'm in Plano, Texas, and that's near Dallas, Collin County. So it looks like that's Caddo, Cherokee, Delaware, Kickapoo, and Tonkawa tribes. It's really good to need to have the reason to learn that now. I'm happy that I know it. And let's see, I'll pass it to is it Brianna?
Yeah, Brianna. I am Brianna, she, her pronouns, and I am on Kickapoo, Peoria, Sac, Meskwaki, Ho-Chunk, Miami, and Sioux land. And I'm in Madison, Wisconsin. And I don't know who hasn't gone because I had started already when I went. So is there like someone want to raise their hand and I'll call on you?
I'm sure Laura hasn't gone. I'm not sure who else yet.
And Alex Steele. Hey.
Right, Laura, do you want to go?
Sure. I'm Laura, she, her pronouns. And currently on Cherokee land in Boone, North Carolina. It's good to be with you all, and I'll pass it to Alex.
I'm Alex, pronouns she, her. I'm on Puyallup land in Tacoma, Washington.
And maybe Debbie hasn't gone.
That's true, because I was taking the eating lunch literally here. So I am Debbie. My pronouns are she, her. And I am currently on the lands of the Kickapoo, the Peoria, the Potawatomi, the Maima, and the Aucassi Sakowajin. I am in Evanston, Illinois.
Thank you, everyone. I believe we're all introduced to each other when other people come on. If any of you, if I'm talking and can't multitask, you can put that little message about how people can introduce themselves on the rename. You can just like copy and paste it back in there so people will know. We're going to be spending quite a bit of time in a 2D environment, but we're 3D humans. And so I wanted to take a minute during our front porch to do a little bit of grounding. So I want you, please, to use your eyes and look around your space and use your ears and listen for what you hear. I remember Terrence saying that there's a fan. Maybe there's music. Maybe the children are screaming. I want you to smell what you smell. And if you have your food, you can taste what you're tasting. Maybe you can reach out and touch something with your hand. The desk, the couch, your hair, your skin. And now that you've really paid attention to your environment and where you are and what's around you, I want you to notice one thing that sparks joy is a weird phrase that is media influenced, something that brings you joy. And it doesn't have to be like you're overwhelmed with joy to the point of just like dancing in the spirit. It could just be like the smallest amount of joy possible. It does not have to be like this huge thing. And I want you to kind of look or smell or taste or touch that thing that brings you joy. And then to maybe in the chat box where you can type it out or even out loud, you can unmute yourself and describe that thing with three words. Okay, so three words to describe the thing you're noticing in the space around you or within you that is bringing you joy today. If you want to unmute, go for it. And if you'd like to write it down, I see Brandon wrote, I'm witnessing my neighbors put together a climbing dome in my backyards, and my kids and my neighbor's kids are going wild on it. Yes. Occupy them kids. Get them outside. A brand new book, Anthony. I see that. I wonder if you're smelling it. Like, you know, like the new book smell. Okay. Probably not on camera. Okay. Trees swaying outside. Food for upcoming parental leave. Ooh, yes. Oh, I see you, Anthony. Hot tea, warm, aromatic, healthful. Three words to describe what's sparking joy. Yes. Oh, I see. Uh-huh. You were just telling people that came in. Thank you. So we're really noticing with all of our senses the thing, something in our space or inside of ourselves that is bringing us a sense of joy, and we're naming those in the chat. Or you can unmute yourself. I don't have to be the only one talking. Old family. Go ahead, V.
I was going to say, as soon as you said it, I was thinking back to Malanese's Love Your Flesh. And I was like, oh, yes. I bring myself joy. Amen. Mm-hmm. I love it.
A breeze coming through the window. Erica and I just got an ornate box turtle. Oh, I want to see. Can we see the box turtle? And her name is T. Morrison. I love that. Oh, that's so great. That's so wonderful. Maybe the box turtle can join our conference today.
I'll take a picture at some point.
Yes, please.
He has beautiful orange legs.
Wow, that's really nice. Small furry creature. That's like a mystery what creature that is. Oh, I see. Hey there, puppy. Nice. So another thing that I was thinking I would like to do as we're kind of gathering here on the front porch, preparing for our time together, again, 3D people in a 2D environment. I think it's really important to take some time, like just noticing our bodies, even though we're going to be like kind of projecting ourselves onto a screen. Well, we're not kind of, we are projecting ourselves onto a screen. And sometimes it's easy to kind of like forget about our humanness. I want you to think about joy or feel about joy or sense all the senses about joy and kind of notice where joy takes shape or where joy is occupied in your body. And it doesn't have to be for all time. It's just like right now. Like you don't have to name the place that joy exists. This is not like some existential question about where joy in your body exists. It's just like right now, if you can think about like a sense of joy, where does that land on your body? And then take a moment and place a hand there. And if you're not able to place a hand there, that's okay. But just like really draw your awareness to that place. And then maybe we'll take a moment and like bring that little, that area some, even more some energy. So like maybe you'll tap that area or you'll rub it, or you might even scratch there or massage there and like kind of wake up the joy senses that might be in that place. Take a moment to do that. I know it's a little bit weird. Sometimes we like forget about our own bodies. And then once you're kind of feeling like, oh, okay, that felt good, and it's kind of woken up a little joy in that spot, then take a minute to pause and sort of notice the like energy, that sounds kind of new agey, but it's true. Like there's energy in your body. There's like electrical current going through, and notice how it's kind of vibrating. And then take a moment and thank you, body. You can say it out loud. You're not on mic, or you can unmic yourself. Thank you, body. Thank you for carrying joy for me. Thank you for being a place that is a container of joy. Thank you, body. We have about 9 minutes until we're gonna kind of open things up to like, you know, real content, although I think this is real too. And we're gonna continue to share with one another. I see that a couple people came on since we were introducing ourselves. I don't know if it's, I should know, because I've seen this name a lot, but the name that says J-A-C-I, I'm not sure if it's Jackie or J-C. But would you mind please introducing yourself by sharing your name, your pronouns? If you know what native land you're on, then share that. And then also your city and state.
Hi, yes, it's JC, and my pronouns are she, her, hers, and I'm on Chumash land in Long Beach, California. What were the other things? Sorry.
Oh, the city and state? You might have just said that. You said California.
Yeah, Long Beach, California. Oh, yeah.
That's it. Perfect. Thank you. And Corbin, I see a name that says Corbin. Would you mind introducing yourself with your name, pronouns, your native land, if you know it, and your city and state?
Hi, I'm Corbin Duncan. My pronouns are they or he. I am a Greensboro native. I live right outside of UNCG, and I have read what those native lands are, but I can't remember them off the top of my head. I'm a musician and artist finishing a degree at UNCG, and I also often work within church settings as a musician.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Melissa Bennett, I see that you just arrived. We're introducing ourselves with our names, pronouns, native land, and city state, if you'd like to.
Hi, thanks for having me here. Yes, my name is Melissa Bennett. My pronouns are she, her, hers. I moved to Madison, Wisconsin about 6 years ago, so I am less familiar with the native lands here, but come from more northern Arizona, where, and that's more of where my roots are, and the native lands there is where I feel more my home is, and the native lands there are the Navajo and Hopi tribes. So that's where I feel like my roots are from, and I'm more connected there. But here, I know there are Ho-Chunk tribes, and that's where I feel like I've heard tribes, but I don't know a lot about the native peoples other than the Ho-Chunk tribe.
So I'm pretty sure that Brianna said that Brianna is from Wisconsin.
Yeah, Brianna Ilene is the one that invited me.
Okay,
to this,
so you know each other.
Facebook. Yeah, so I saw the connection through Brianna Ilene, and Yeah, so I was really excited when I saw on her Facebook page and saw the ad. It sounds like just an amazing idea, and I'm really excited to be here and hear all about what you guys are doing and this movement. Decentralized racial justice focused church is right up my alley, and just I'm really excited about what this whole idea is.
Welcome, welcome, welcome. Karen, I see that you are on here. We're introducing ourselves. Oh, V, you have something.
Can I just say real quick, Karen is the best. And Karen is our book cover designer. So from Queen, can y'all say hi to Karen and say great job? We loved it. So that is my introduction of Karen, but you can go ahead and let them know who you are now. Just want to give you a shout out, girl.
Unmute yourself.
We're doing introductions, who you are, where you're from. If you know the native land that you're on, that's how we're introducing ourselves today.
Okay. Let me go. Karen Archia in Greensboro, North Carolina. I do not know the native lands I'm on. I am part of Good Neighbor Movement and part of the women-centered city village that we call College Hill because it started in that historic neighborhood where I had a shop, and we sort of maintained that name, although we're not necessarily centrally located there anymore. But we are a woman autonomous group.
Wonderful. I'm looking around to see if there's anybody else that wasn't able to share their name, and but I'm pretty sure that everybody has introduced themselves. There's about 4 minutes until we start our kind of main programming. Of course, at any time, I don't need to give you all this permission, but at any time, if you need to get up and turn off the screen and use the restroom or have a bio break or do any of the things that you need to do, y'all know the Zoom world, you're able to do that. So just kind of give yourselves the space so that you can receive well throughout this time together. Okay, well, is there anything else? Does anybody else see anybody? Or I heard so many St. Louis connections and so many Greensboro connections. I don't know if somebody wants to just say like, hey, so-and-so, I see you over there. So this is your time to do that on the front porch here.
Hi, Karen.
Hi, Melanie's.
Hey.
Enjoyed you last night. I took notes.
Thank you. Thanks be to God.
Mm-hmm. Who has the best snack with them for this conference? I already saw the Cheez-Its. I already made that comment. Anybody else got something good? I don't even see any. Are y'all the kind of people that turn off the camera when you eat?
I made myself some fig cake this morning.
Ooh.
I've already had my coffee and pancakes, so I'm good.
I have enchiladas made by my grandchildren.
Ooh, nice.
I'm warming up ribs and macaroni and cheese, so I will keep the camera off while I consume that.
Welcome to the folks that came in. That's there's one that says Kip, and then there's Allison, and then there's Stephanie, and then there's another Stephanie and Adam. If y'all want to take a minute to share your name, your pronoun, what native land you're on, and what city and state, you're welcome to do that. And I don't want to call anybody because I feel like y'all are just coming in, and I don't want you to like feel bamboozled, or what's the word? I don't know what the word is. Anyway, but if anybody wants to unmic themselves, and I also see that Lauren joined Brandon and might want to introduce themselves to the room as well. So, but they also look like they're having a good old time over there. Okay, so if you'd like to introduce yourself, we got another minute. Name, pronoun, native land, city, state.
Oh, hi, I'm Kip.
He, him. I'm in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, which is Lenni Lenape land.
Welcome. Anybody else, if you are wanting to introduce yourself, don't forget to unmute.
Hello, my name's Adam, and I'm here with my wife, Stephanie, he, him. We live in Evanston, Illinois, and we're glad to be joining with you. We were able to listen to last night's stream a little bit after it happened, but it was good to connect with you in that way, and looking forward to what comes next here.
Yeah, Stephanie, she, her, and I think we're on Miami and Illini land, but I also believe there have been several tribes that have lived here throughout the history.
Welcome, everyone. We have hit the 2 o'clock mark. And so we'll have time at the end to have some more informal hangout front porch space again. So if you weren't able to introduce yourself and you'd like to later, if you just want to give a shout out to somebody that you know on the screen or any of those kinds of things, you can always do that in the chat box. But we'll also have some informal time to kind of hang out at the end of the conference today. So that's an opportunity as well. I see that Teddy introduced himself. Long Beach, California. So if you want to introduce yourself with your name, pronouns, native land, where you are in the world, and any other things, you're welcome to do that on the chat as well. Okay, and with that, welcome. Glad you're here. And I'm going to pass it over to Anthony. Oh, don't forget to unmute yourself, Anthony.
I should notice by now. And so welcome again to everybody to the Liberating Church gathering in the 21st century Hush Harbors. My name is Anthony Smith. I'm a team member with Liberating Church Project. Also, I'm on a pastoral team of Mission House in Salisbury, North Carolina. And so we're glad that you have joined us again today for this second day of gathering. I'm sure like many of you, I'm still in the glow of yesterday. Still in the spirit from yesterday. So I just want to thank and give mad love to our Reverend, where's she at? Reverend Lenise, my Lenise, as Brandon says. And I look forward to meeting you in person one day because y'all just right off the road. And so okay, I look forward to that. So I'm still, like many of you, I'm sure, are still chewing on that word. It was a whole prophetic word. And so just grateful to be with y'all as we shared in that time together last night. And so a couple things I want to encourage you to do. One, if you could, if you have a camera, if you could turn it on so we can see your shiny, beautiful face so you can join in with us so we can see you with this. And also, while you are not talking, if you're not part of a if you're not have your name called for having your hand raised, if you could keep your mics muted unless you're called upon to speak or it's your turn to speak for whatever reason. And so those are kind of my initial openings. Again, welcome to everybody. If you're just coming in right now, we're glad that you are here with us. And so I just want to start with an opening prayer. But actually, before we do the prayer, I want to do something that's a part of our community and many other communities that are connected in who have demonstrated the 8 marks of a liberating church that you, that many of you are probably connected with that you'll hear about today. And one of those practices is the invocation of ancestors. It's calling upon our ancestors to be present with us, for us to be aware of their wisdom and their experience, their strength. And so what I want to do is open up for the chat. If you could place in the chat the name of an ancestor. When you begin to think about this kind of work that we're talking about, this work of being a prophetic presence, a revolutionary presence of the kingdom, a liberating presence, a transformative presence in your community, I want you to think about an ancestor that rises up within you. The ancestor that rises up within me, and I just want to name it. Name her is Mother Harriet Tubman. She's been in my spirit for a long time, especially during this pandemic. I've been calling out to her during this time. And so if you could just write in the chat the name of an ancestor that really speaks to you, that comes to your consciousness as you think about this moment that we're in right now. So just name and honor your ancestors. Somebody said Loretta Hall, Audre Lorde, Carmen Lozada, Shipron Pua, yeah, Hinton Jones, Lillian Smith, Septima Clark, Marsha Johnson, Lily Vaden, Fannie Lou Hamer, Derek Bell, John Coltrane, Doris Esco. Amen. And I would encourage you, if nobody else is listening, Ella Baker, yes. Verna, my mom, hey. Amen. Abby Lincoln, Alma Thomas, Abby Lincoln, okay. My great-grandmother Ella, Clarence Jordan. Amen. Luther McDuffie Holman. Art Blakely. Blakey, Julie Bulwer, Malcolm X, Malik El Shabazz, yeah, Donny Hathaway. Donny Hathaway. All right. And so there's a reason why these faces, these names, these energies, these presence, these memories come up when we are gathering like this, whenever we gather in our communities, because they know when to be, they know when to show up. They know how to show up. And so may we be able to live into, lean into that wisdom, that experience that they would give us, that they continue to give us. Amen. James Baldwin, my grandmother, B.B. Comer, Sojourner Truth, Dr. Peter Henderson Bryce. Amen. So hold on to that, make note of that. Anybody else that come, any other ancestor that comes up as we proceed for the rest of the day, hold on to that, think about that. There's a reason why they're coming up, amen. So let's pray. Holy and gracious God, Lord, we thank you for again, coming together as community, as Liberating Church. God, may your spirit once again fill this time. Feel this space, this digital space, because God, we know that although many of us are all across the country, different states, different locations, that digitally, God, that we are to be present with us, but we know that there's no distance in your spirit, God. And so God, we just lift up everybody who's gathered here today and those who cannot make it, God, we just thank you for your grace, your mercy, your love, your presence today. God, speak to your people like only you can. Speak through us. God, may people find encouragement today. God, may people find wisdom today. And God, I'll even dare ask, God, that you will even give us discernment today for all our respective contexts and communities and neighborhoods that we're all a part of. God, how we can join in the revolutionary work, liberating work of your spirit in our communities. God, bless the presenters, bless the panelists, bless our participants, bless those behind the scenes with the technology, God. Make this a beautiful moment of shalom and blessing for all. God, we thank you for these things in Jesus' name. Amen and ashe. And so now I'm gonna turn it over to Whitney and Laura to give background of the Liberating Church.
Hey y'all, I'm Whitney. I'm one of the team members with Liberating Church, and we're kind of kicking off by giving you a bit of understanding of what this project is about. And I'm going to do that first by showing you our timeline of the work that we've done together. If we can have Simone, if you can get that slide up. Awesome. So our project began in September 2017. With Brandon and a dream and an email, you might say. You should ask him about that amazing email, but began September 2017. And October 2017 through June of the following year was a period of developing the vision of this project, developing strategic partnerships with people who would be excited to be a part of this project, and figuring out a timeline and a way forward to figure out funding to support this project. And then July 2017 through January of 2018 was historical Hush Harbor research. And that's a bit of what I talked about yesterday. That was doing a lot of reading, a lot of engaging with scholars and elder advisors, and learning stories of enslaved African people who shared in interviews their experiences in Hush Harbor. So we spent that period of time doing research. And then in November of 2018, we received a Louisville Institute grant that in large part funded our project. So that was very exciting. In February 2019, we all gathered as a leadership team and condensed all of that research we had done into 8 marks of Hush Harbors that Laura's gonna tell you about next. And then February 2019 through August of 2019, we did ethnographic research, which means we identified communities that embodied this Hush Harbor spirit. And we met with them. We went to their worship experiences, and we talked with leadership. We talked with their ministry partners and learned about what those communities were all about. And then September 2019 through January of this year, we analyzed all that research. And then February of this year through just last month, August, we developed our research conclusions and began pulling all of that historical research, all of that ethnographic research into a book that we're working on. And then that led to here. So September 2020, Liberating Church Conference, you're here. Hope you know that you're here. We're very glad that you're here. And then our final timeline, which I should add, is only the final timeline for now. You know, we expect that things are gonna come and gonna grow and gonna develop and be born out of this project. But for this year, our final timeline is December 2020, when we anticipate that we will release our book that we're hoping to be a very accessible, exciting, energetic resource to help Christian communities and really many different communities understand what the Hush Harbors were all about and how contemporary 21st century communities are embodying this abolitionist spirit. So yeah, so that's our timeline. And now Laura is gonna go into more detail about these 8 marks that we condense the Hush Harbors into.
Thanks, Whitney. Hey, everybody. So yeah, through that process of the historical research and looking at the pre-Civil War Hush Harbors, and then looking at the modern 21st century Hush Harbors, the Liberating Church team distilled down these 8 marks that are characteristics of those early Hush Harbors, and then also describe the ways that Liberating Churches today are carrying forward that tradition. So the first mark is stay woke, or we also say staying in the wake, drawing on the work of Christina Sharp, describing wake in the breadth of all its meaning as keeping watch with the dead, the path of a slave ship, the consequence of something, awakening and consciousness. This mark is about realizing the ongoing effects of slavery in our world today and responding to shared pain. It includes the deep soul work of remembering and remembering, as well as work around awareness and education and advocacy. Talking Book harkens back to how the true liberating spirit of scripture was revealed to enslaved Africans in Hush Harbors. And in spite of the slaveholder religion that had been taught to them in plantation church. And it is about spirit and mystery, about memory and story, and reading scripture through a lens of resistance and liberation. North Star draws on the symbolism of the literal star that guided Africans who were enslaved and running towards freedom in the north. And it represents the possibility
of a new world. And for Liberating Churches today, it's about imagining and creating spaces of freedom to escape and protest the systems of oppression and domination all around and even within us. Sankofa is an idea originating from the Akan people of West Africa that's been translated as meaning it's not taboo to go back and fetch what is at risk of being left behind. It's symbolized by a bird flying forward while looking backward. And for Liberating Churches today, it's about reclaiming ancestral practices, telling the stories of what has been in order to inspire and give courage for today's struggles, and about being embodied and rooted in place. The fifth mark is All God's Children Got Shoes. It draws from the spiritual where enslaved persons proclaimed in song the dignity, the equality, the belovedness that they had in God's sight, despite, again, slaveholders' insistence on the opposite. And this mark is about subverting hierarchies, about practicing egalitarian leadership, centering marginalized voices, knowing that everyone can lead, that we are all leaderful. Joy Unspeakable is a mark that embraces non-dualism, mystery, Holy Spirit power. The poem Joy Unspeakable from Barbara Holmes's book of that same title, Joy Unspeakable, Contemplative Practices of the Black Church, kind of encapsulates the spirit of Joy Unspeakable with lines like, "For Africana members of the invisible institutions, the emerging Black Church, Joy Unspeakable is practicing freedom while chains still chafe, singing deliverance while Jim Crow stalks, trusting God's healing and home remedies, prayers, kerosene, and cow patty tea." And the closing line of that poem is, "Joy Unspeakable is a symphony of incongruities, of faces aglow and hearts on fire, and the wonder of surviving together." Then the last two marks were ones that actually showed up the most in our research, and those are Steal Away, again drawing on a spiritual, steal away to Jesus, to symbolize that dissident discipleship that Reverend Lanice talked about last night. It includes ideas of fugitivity, agitating and testing, breaking norms, being hidden in plain sight. And last, Ubuntu, a Zulu word that can be translated as "I am because we are," is about living an ethic of radical love. It shows up as intergenerational healing and wholeness, trust and intimacy and accountability and support. So that was a really quick overview. You'll be hearing more about each of these marks and how they're showing up in the communities that are gonna be sharing on our panel. But I also encourage you to visit liberatingchurch.org, where we've got blog posts that dive deeper into each one of these eight marks. And also, if you didn't see the videos on the Liberating Church Facebook page that Vanikia and Anthony and Simone did, I encourage you to check those out too. They also give some beautiful insight into what some of these marks look like and what they mean for us today. So I'm going to turn it over now to Vanikia to share about Church on the Margins.
Thank you so much for that, Whitney and Laura. Welcome to everyone who's making their way in. What we're about to enter into is just giving an overview of the changing landscape of the church. Myself, along with my brother Terrence Hawkins, will be doing this sort of as a tag team presentation. But I want to make a quick note. I hope from what you've seen from the welcome up until now is that we are not a church. We are not a congregation that's gathering. A lot of you all have had questions about if we have chapters, where you are. We are a team that has conducted this research, and we hope to provide resources in which you can create the liberating spaces you hope to live in and hope to embody. So I do want to make that clear before we go any further. Now, let's set the scene. The year is 1862. It is New Year's Eve, December 31st, 1862. If any of you are familiar with the Black church tradition of Watch Night, it is actually the day that it was started. And what was happening on that eve was the enslaved Africans heard word that emancipation was coming, and they were waiting on a telegram, one that would be received on January 1st, 1863. Now let's teleport, fast forward to Watch Night, 2019. Many of y'all, if y'all were there, you heard your preachers talking about 2020 vision. It is the year where things are made clear. You're going to receive that clear sight. You're going to be walking in that sight. Things are going to be shown to you. And yes, they were. Those words that came out of those folks of God's mouth, it's proof that we only see and know in part, my Lord. So yeah, I just want to make that clear. 2020 is doing the work of revealing some things. Brother Terrence, tell us what it's doing.
Yeah, thanks. We see in part, we know in part. And I just think about, you know, the tradition within the Black church, the sort of theme, the year, and a lot of times it rhymes. And so this year we have the 2020 vision. And too often across color, culture, creed lines, in our faith spaces, our life together is more ordered by a sense of narcissistic triumphalism and shallow optimism. So that when we uttered something like 2020 vision, there was no way we could imagine that 2020 vision would actually be in the form of an upheaval, that it would be in the form of a painful uncovering. And so we all find ourselves in this apocalyptic moment in the truest sense of the word. Apocalypse means to unmask, uncover, or unveil something. And so this moment is truly unmasked so much for those who, for one reason or another, were not aware of the way this empire is set up and the way it has been set up for so long. You know, we often talk about the word apocalypse and connect it to things like a rapture, you know, escaping the world and going to the heavenlies. But truly, apocalypse is a rupture. It's a cutting through the fog that forces us to confront the world that is. And the world that is, as we look around, is pretty jacked up and toe up from the flow up, ain't it, y'all? It's pretty bad. But as Christina Sharp says in her book, In the Wake, she says, the past that is not past always reappears to rupture the present. And so what we're seeing is a reappearing of a past. One preacher said, we're dealing with the double virus, COVID-19 and 1619. This disease of white supremacy that has run through the body politic of this empire from its inception, along with this pandemic. And so much is being unveiled and uncovered, and we're forced to grapple and deal with things that often we want to try to sweep under the rug. And so this changing social landscape is an opportunity, and we believe that the hush harbors provide us wisdom and a path forward. And so as we see uprisings in the street, as we see cries for justice, as we see pain and trauma, we can look back. We can go back and fetch this tradition of the hush harbor and carry it forward in the moment in ways that are transformative. V?
That's beautiful. That's beautiful. And I think it flows so well into what Malanise showed us and taught us last night. What does it mean for us to be the church in this moment? When you're not in your buildings, when you ain't seeing your people like you want to for Bible study and Sunday morning gatherings or Saturday night, hey, gathering folks. What does it mean to actually be the people of God and to be the church of God? I want to hearken back to what Laura shared with us. I believe it means those eight marks that we've seen. So just stay with me as I reveal this and tie in these marks together for you. We are doing the work of Sankofa, which means reaching back and getting what our ancestors have left behind for us. We are guided by our North Star, being led into a new world, yet a world that has been with us for centuries. This is a world in which all God's children got shoes, and they have equal say-so into how we live, move, and have our being. The Spirit of God sustains us with joy unspeakable. The talking book, the Word of God, is one that speaks to us and we speak back to it. The work ahead of us demands that we stay woke and remain committed to seeing the liberative realities of heaven being made felt and known here on earth. What this looks like? It means that we create mutually created and sustained spaces done through the mark of Ubuntu, We have to do this together, in which trust and intimacy are actually tangible things. We love each other in real ways. Like I said in our video, both in word and in deed. And we steal away. I noted this in our video. Y'all, for y'all who made it here, you might have thought that it was difficult to get here. You were probably hoping that information was a bit more accessible, posted everywhere so you could just click and come. But everybody ain't able. And we wanted this to be a space in which those who were committed to finding us, who were committed to the work, those who could be vetted by people that we know and love, would be welcomed into the space. It is an alternative. We probably wouldn't even be on Zoom if we had other alternatives. So truly, we're using what's made available to us. That's the reason why we're not streaming to Facebook today. We want to make sure that those who are in the room, we create this brave and safe space where we hold one another well. And so that's even why we ask you to honor the work of, yes, invite your people in, but don't just share willy-nilly who all's coming. Make sure that you are actually vetting the folks who are coming into this. So I hope that you can see, even as we've discussed the marks, the work that we've done, and how we conduct this conference, that we're hoping to live out these marks, even as we're not a church. Just as we are the people of God together, we're hoping to live and embody these things. So we invite you into that. Terrence, can you talk about more about that upheaval, that undoing? What does it mean for us? You use the phrase about a past that ain't the past. Like, what does it mean for the pandemic to be a moment in which we're being teleported? Come on. Yeah.
I'm thinking of this Black church proverb. Y'all probably know it. You can take the people out of Egypt, but you can't take the Egypt out of the people. And in a certain way, this is a moment where we're being forced to grapple with the ways in which the church is a nexus of empire, of Egypt, of Babylon, and how God wants us to practice something different, something that's freeing, something that's rooted in love. There's one writer that said that the pandemic is a portal. The pandemic is a portal. There, in all of the tragedy, in all of the heartbreak, and all of the incredible loss, we don't want to try to paint it with a silver lining. We just want to name the fact that there is an opening. We're being forced to grapple with some things in ways that in many seasons before we would not grapple. And so, it's important that we think about, you know, the reality that we can't go back to what was. I don't know if this has really got down deep in your soul yet, but ain't no going back. I reminded of Harriet Tubman's words where she would say, if you hear the dogs bark, keep going. And so the dog of COVID-19 and 1619 is barking. Mm-hmm. And it's been barking in our institutions, but there's no going back. But that's a beautiful thing. That's a beautiful window and opportunity for us. And so I'll close my thoughts with words from Sister Sonia Renee Taylor. She says this about our moment. We will not go back to normal. Normal never was. Our pre-corona existence was not normal, other than we normalized greed, inequity, exhaustion, depletion, extraction, disconnection, confusion, rage, hoarding, hate, and lack. We should not long to return, my friends. We are being given an opportunity to stitch a new garment, one that fits all of humanity and nature. And the way Jesus of Nazareth said it is that you don't pour new wine into old wineskins. We're given the opportunity to pour new wine and new wineskins.
I love it. I love it. So the Spirit of God is doing that new thing, a thing that we're anticipating. But again, that proclamation of freedom, liberation, and what it means for us to walk in that freedom is coming. And so what does it look like for us to walk into that fully? I wish we had enough time, but this setting will not allow for that. So Simone, if you can share the next slide. We have made hints at a book that we have coming out, and I am so excited. It will be before the close of this year. Do you have that? Beautiful. So we have this book coming soon. So excited. I do want to shout out our good friend Karen, who's on the line. If you could wave to the folks. She is the designer of this beautiful image. I am so excited, just moved by it. We had a meeting in which we were talking. Every piece of this is intentional. We had a lot of fun talking through the text and the text having movement, there being differentiation, but it all coming together beautifully and giving you this wild, chaotic, but contained sort of feeling. So she did such a beautiful job of communicating that visually. And I am just as excited about the content of this book. So I hope that you all who are wanting to stay connected with us will keep an eye out for that and just get your hearts and minds ready. Our hope is to have it available both like as an ebook and then also the option to have print. So just keep an eye out, follow us. You found us here, so you can find us again. as I'm saying that, Terrence, I wanna invite you to give us an invitation into reflection.
Okay. Yeah, I just think, again, let's just pause for a few moments and think about the opening that's before us and the commitment that we must embrace to walk through it. There's an opening before us. In Revelation, it says, I set before you an open door. And so an open door has been set before us. Revolutionary Jesus is knocking at the door of your heart, asking you, will you walk this walk in this critical moment? And so I'll just leave it at that. We're going to actually, this is a good transition. We're going to take a brief break, a bathroom break, a stretch break, whatever you need to do. If you want to stay on, we're going to play a little music, but we'll be back in about 4 to 5 minutes. Again, take a breather, take a little break, step away, turn off your screen, whatever you need to do to sort of reset yourself so that we can continue in this important conversation. Thank you.
Super good. Englewood. Purple rain falling down on the prince of the coast with the sunshine all year round. Purple haze over landscape, still I hydrate in the lunch line. With the smog and clouds, what? Star me out. This song's in the key of life, and love is in need of more. Young from Englewood, barefoot on the cedar floor. If black music is the blood, then my heart has been beating more. Rapidly, happily, I look back on a Afeni Shakur. Her son paved the way, now all eyes on me. Cause I'm young, black, and gifted, Nina, all eyes gon' see. Swung back when faced with a challenge that's meant to break you and balance scales. You ain't average, now throw your hands on three. Gon' put them up for black magic.
Black excellence, black habits, this black medicine, everything black.
Black chucks, black chucks, everything.
Everything black.
Black hug, black love, everything.
Praise black Jesus, play black Moses. Give them flowers while they still hear the black roses. Everything black.
Black tribe, black ride, everything.
Everything black.
Black pride, black lives, everything. Skin noir, friends noir, here you are, black. Everything you need, better believe you are that. Skin noir, friends noir, here you are, black. Every time they hear this, they gon' say he made an anthem. Life ain't a panda. It ain't black and white, it's a canvas. Spike Lee your dreams and Bruce Lee your tantrums. 2-3 that bull, then go Michael Jordan, go Samson. Knock down the walls around me, strong and dark and so handsome.
Everything around me is shining dark and the time is divine. I found a spark when the clouds leak and the rain falling. I found peace. I'm black as the concrete, black as the street that's lined with the palm trees. I'm black as the night sky when you broken your radio, bacon just don't meet. Black as the bottom of Chuck Taylor's, black on some haters. Black as the burnt rubber hitting donuts in front of the store with 2 months later. They got stopped in the cops, found a black burner underneath the seat on some Nat Turner. Black as the judge roll when the case closed, now your life on the back burner.
Black magic.
Black magic.
Black excellence.
Black excellence.
Black habits.
Black habits.
It's black medicine.
Yeah.
Everything black.
Black chucks. Black chucks. Everything.
Everything.
Black hug. Black love. Everything.
Praise black Jesus.
Yeah.
Play black Moses. Give them flowers while they still hear black roses. Everything black.
Black tribe. Black ride. Everything.
Everything black.
Black pride. Black lives. Everything. Skin noir. Friends noir. Here you are. Black. Everything you need, better believe you are that. Skin noir, friends noir, here you are, black. Everything you need, better believe you are that, yeah. Mira negritos, puro amor pa' mis morenitos. Hice un giro, cambiando idioma. Huele palomas encima de rollercoaster calle, cerca de la playa, ocean view. Black of the berry, the sweet of the juice. We dance in a soca too. Only fuck a few real just to chill with us, build with us, to deal with us. Never pull the trigger aiming at another man, but real hitters still pick up the phone.
Hey, smoke what you need.
I ain't on the alone. Used to dream of really stacking my funds. Now my window's just as black as my gun. I feel divine. It came on time. God never changes, ain't gon' lie. I lost faith and cried, then my faith revived. And as soon as I let go and surrendered to him my talents, this young king took off like Go-Go Gadget. There go that black magic.
Black excellence, black habits, this black medicine, everything black.
Black chucks, black chucks, everything.
Everything black.
Black hug, black love, everything.
Praise black Jesus, play black Moses. Give them flowers while they still hear black roses. Everything black.
Black tribe, black ride, everything.
Everything black.
Black pride, black lives, everything.
Welcome back, welcome back, welcome back, everyone. I hope that you enjoyed that break and that song. We thank Black Jesus for D Smoke and Black Habits. I am a fan, I am a fan. I want to now transition us into our time of hearing from the 21st Century Hush Harbors. If you have your registrant schedule in front of you, you saw some of those sites listed. We have our friends from The Gathering and located in Dallas, Texas with us. Mission House located in Salisbury, North Carolina. QC Family Tree, which is in Charlotte, North Carolina. The Northeast Winston Hush Harbor, and also the Good Neighbor Movement located in Greensboro, 336, what up? So I do want to now invite those panelists. Brandon, how you doing, friend? If you all can take turns just saying who is representing your community today, talk to the people, just your names and which community you're representing.
Greetings, I am Camila House Sharp. I'm representing The Gathering, a womanist church in Dallas.
Welcome.
Anthony Smith, representing Mission House in Salisbury, North Carolina.
Welcome, welcome.
We are Helms and Greg from QC Family Tree in Charlotte, North Carolina.
Hey, Greg. Hey, Helms.
Terrence Hawkins, representing the Nameless Hush Harbor. We'll be in the Northeast Ward of Winston-Salem.
I was literally going to put Nameless on the sheet, but that was hard to do. So we opted with Northeast Winston. Glad you're here. Brandon and Lauren, how y'all doing?
Hey, hey, what's up, y'all? We are Good Neighbor Movement in Greensboro, 336.
We love to see it. We love to see it. So I want to start off by asking the gathering, hey, I would love to know which of the 8 marks that we've listed that you were presented with were maybe the most challenging and difficult for you to live into and attempt to embody.
You know, I wrestled with this. I even called my co-pastor our session and was like, okay, let's look at these marks and kind of think about this. I think with us, the Sankofa is probably the most difficult. And I think we live into it to a certain extent. Where I think I would like to see us live into it more is more of reaching back in more rituals and things like that with our ancestors. I think because it was never supposed to be a church, but the way it formed as a church, has shaped the way we ended up being. And I think, Sankofa would probably be the one we have struggled with the most that I can see of.
Is there any other site that's present here that has the same feeling that Sankofa was really difficult for you to try and live out? Or if not, what was another one that maybe you, Terrence, found in your nameless gathering space, what was difficult there to really live out?
Yeah, I won't use the word shame, but I'm ashamed to say this, but as an Afro-Methodical, the hardest thing for us to live out was the unspeakable joy piece, because we meet in a house and a lot of our tradition, now obviously not the hush harbors, but a lot of how we engage the spirit is, you know, connected to Hammond B3s and, you know, having a full musical type of gathering. And a lot of us are musicians and singers, but we just, you know, most of the time just sing songs a cappella off the cuff. And so just that, like, being caught up in the Holy Ghost together, I think has been the most difficult to practice in the house space for whatever reason.
No, that is good to know, and I think it's good for people to hear. I'm curious, thank you, Simone, for putting those marks in the chat. As I'm asking what marks are difficult to live out, it's the ones that were shown to you previously. But I'm curious, maybe Anthony, because I know you love the word discernment. I'm wondering what it looks like for you to discern what it is that your community needs. Because maybe you don't see these marks being lived out fully in the same way to the same degree. So how do you discern in what moment what it is that you lean into and what you can pull back from?
So a lot of our leadership and people in our community and Mission House come from like a Pentecostal background. And so a lot of us have a very Pentecostal spirituality to the way we worship, the way we gather together. And so the thing is, the uniqueness of our congregation or our community is that we try to inform ourselves in many different ways that Christian communities, Jesus communities have engaged in a work of discernment. So that is leaning into contemplative practices, from Lectio Divina to prayerful reading of scripture, to examine, to more, because a lot of times in a Western contemplative tradition, it's always about silence. But what we've learned is that there's some value in that. But what we also learned is there's discernment in the shout. There's discernment in the dance. There's discernment in the preaching. Right. And so we have very, like in my church, in our church, I should say, we have very powerful Black women that are gifted with the spirit in our community that prophesy. And so our discernment comes from, yes, in solitude and silence, but also our discernment comes through profound prophetic utterance, speaking in tongues with interpretation. These kind of things happen in our midst. There's some Sunday mornings when we may have our flow planned out, but the spirit breaks out. And so I remember one Sunday, just as an example of living into this, one Sunday we had a worship gathering. If you have been to a Pentecostal church, and we're a little different, we're Pentecostal, but social justice warriors too, is that we had one Sunday where the Spirit had broke out so powerfully. We had little children laying hands on adults. Children were laying hands on people.
Let them lead us. Let them lead us.
It was not planned. It wasn't, you know, we had a little a boy in our community. He's like 6 years old. We put oil in his hands. He wanted to pray for me. He put his little oily hand on my bald head, and he began to pray. And what he didn't realize what he was doing, he may have realized this, but he was prophesying to me. And so that's one of the ways. And so I think and this goes back to the hush harbors, right?
Yeah.
When we yield our bodies and our minds to the Spirit, and a lot of times we are in religious contexts that don't know how to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was raised around Black women that did that. And so that's my norm. And so that's one of the ways we lean into that.
Thank you. Thank you. What a blessing. What a blessing. Helms and Greg over at QCE Family Tree. I'm curious as to what it looks like. How do you like design a liberating church within your space? And also speak to us. I know a few folks have asked about the racial makeup of things, but Malanise told us so beautifully last night, not to play into identity politics. Folks who are doing that liberating work, let the liberation look how it looks. So what does it look like for you within your space to embody these marks that we're talking about?
I'm gonna speak first.
Go ahead.
So I think so to answer the question for us in the, from the racial context of being white people in a mostly Black neighborhood, and working in very mixed race settings. I think first and foremost, it's been really important for us in a leadership position to always listen and to always just allow other folks to sort of direct. What does this space need to look like? How does it need to be set up? What's the feel of it? And to have sunk ourselves as deeply as we can into the sort of the Hush Harbor tradition, and just to absorb it as best we can, and to allow it to be to encourage the reflection of that in our space, and in our language and in our practices, and so just basically to be learners and to sort of facilitate the way that we've been able to learn from being immersed in the context that we're in.
Maybe too, like a long line of unlearning, because like when you're talking about what is the most challenging mark, the one that came to mind was all God's children got shoes, not because we don't have other folks in leadership, because that exists, but like what does leader mean? How do you measure if somebody is a quote good leader or an effective leader? Yeah. How do you develop leadership when the alternative leadership looks like servanthood? It also looks like agency, self-agency. It looks like so many different things than what we're like kind of taught in school and in society. And so a great deal of unlearning and failing a lot at like kind of old models that we try and then just try again. And I also think too that another challenge for us is that our community, so to speak, is ever changing and ever evolving. Like the human beings that are in the community are ever changing, ever evolving. The environment is ever changing and ever evolving. Like literally, like the furniture and the everything is always changing and evolving. And where sometimes that is good and necessary and just a part of how things are, it also involves quite a bit of grief and something close to pain. And so trying to move through that in like gracious and spacious ways is a challenge that I find myself kind of being in frequently.
That's a word. Brandon and Lauren, I want to ask you, and it sort of feeds out of what Helms and Greg have shared, what has been risky about living this type of life, about doing this type of work, not just within your most immediate context, but even how you show up within the world around you. So I know you all to be folks who, just like Mission House, social justice folks, what is the cost? What is at risk when you live in such a way?
We want to thank you for that, V. We also want to shout out, Karen is joining us, just not in the same physical location, joining us.
Hey, Karen, come talk to us, girl.
So Karen, jump in on this.
Yeah. Hey, everyone. My name is Lauren Cunningham. Super excited to be with you all here today. I'm here in Greensboro with Good Neighbor Movement, sitting next to be, and happy to be with Karen too. So Karen, feel free to unmute yourself and hop on in here as we dive into this question. Good to be with you all. I think I want to first say that I think one of the challenging pieces that is also risky for us, but challenging, is this idea, this mark of staying woke, and responding to the shared and collective pain that we see in our community. We have so many things that are happening right now. It's not just the pandemic, but we have the uprising people, the grief, the loss that people are holding, and the response to injustice, to police brutality, to the reign of white supremacy, and the destruction, the death dealing that is happening, that we're witnessing, there, along with what's happening environmentally around the country. The fight seems so incredibly layered. It is so incredibly layered and complex right now. So discernment, what Anthony was sharing, this contemplative practice and coming and allowing spirit to guide us with others in community. For folks that know a little bit about the neighbor movement, you know, we operate outside of a building. We are deconstructed. We are journeying alongside people in the neighborhoods, in communities. And so a challenge, I think that is a good challenge for us, staying present, staying connected, so that we can discern what is our work to do together. It's always that challenge before us. And so that is a risk for us, because we're operating on the margins. And so I'm gonna stop there and invite Karen and B to hop in too.
You got something you want to go first? No? Okay. All right. I think something else around risk. There's a risk just in the gathering, like in gathering itself. The way that we're structured and organized is, our primary structure is around these spiritually rooted activist groups that are decentralizing across the city. And so there's a risk in that. There's a risk to the institution. We're connected to a denomination. There's a risk in that we just can't embody the metrics that they determine success to look like. It's a risk to the people who gather in those activist groups, because there's an invitation to show up fully and to contribute and not just to consume. Even though I, for example, am an ordained person within the denomination, I'm not leading those groups. And so there's a risk in the sense that people have to put themselves on the line. And that's a risk when everything about how we've been socialized and the way we've been theologized is to look to someone else. Mm-hmm. What Reverend Lee referred to look up, where we've been trained, we've been socialized to look up at someone else, to look up at God, right? Whereas we are inviting people to look inside, and to look around them at their neighbors. That's very risky. And then last thing I'll say in terms of the risk of gathering is that when you are organized in that kind of a way, again, the hush harbors were stealing away. Not everybody was welcome to join. Not all enslaved Black people were welcome to the hush
harbors. Right.
because they had to be vetted, because they would tell, they would snitch.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's a very real sense in which every time, and at the same time, we had to get our people free. And so there's a tension there. And so there's a risk around both the gathered, you know, the biblical language is the gathered life and the scattered life. So when we gather, it's a risk. But when we go back out into the community to do the work of justice and healing, where we just might meet people who we believe God is calling us to gather in a more intimate way, right, to come back together gathering, there's a risk there because that person could actually be a spy. Right, like, you know, like to, if you want to, I'm using the Hush Harbor narrative. Some people, our own people, often, right, like people who were claiming, who are our sort of kin folks in terms of race, they were often not for us. And so, you know, I think about, for example, our queer and trans members that are part of these our gathered life. Like, what does it mean for them to open themselves up to invite in folks that present one way with their analysis or their language? They can talk the right talk or they show up in the right spaces, but it doesn't mean that they've been changed in the inside. Mm-hmm. But, and we can't be changed unless we journey in community, like what Reverend Lanice was saying. So there's a risk in that, so.
No, absolutely. It gets messy when you start adding people in. Like, you have your plans, you have your thoughts of how it should go, and then somebody show up who just don't fit. Mm-hmm. But the plan that you had. So yes, learning how to shift again goes with that discernment piece. Thank you all for sharing. My question that I want to pose to each of you all, from what you've already experienced, hope to experience in the days to come, what would you have to say to the folks who are listening, who will be watching, in terms of just a prophetic challenge, encouragement, whatever it might be that would help carry them off into their spaces, whether they're the person who's the messenger, like, let me tell you how we do this thing, they're the person who's trying to kick it off, how they're shaping it, whatever that might be, what would you have to say to them? And I wanna invite you, Sister Camila, to tell us first what you got for us.
Yeah, that's a good question. I would say first, Be you. I mean, that is the first, you know, we are all talking about the different ways that we are doing this work, and we're doing it in our own different ways, because I believe God has gifted us and called us to do it in our own different ways, but we're still all doing the work. So, you know, while you can take things from people on best practices, you don't have to do it the way somebody else is doing. Do it the way that is going to work with you and your community. That's my first thing. And I'm a follower of Jesus. So, you know, if you're going into this thing, I always tell people, don't just preach Jesus, go be like Jesus. Go do and be the way that Jesus was being in the community with the people, and love the people. That's the only thing for me, that's the only thing that can really keep me going on a lot of this stuff is, love for the people. But my biggest thing, and anybody from the gathering, take care of yourself, because in the words of my friend Chelsea Yarbrough, be excellent and be well, but if you have to choose one, be well.
That's good. That is good. Thank you for that reminder. Brother Terrence, what would you have to say to the folks who are journeying along this road? They done tried the things, they know that it don't work, and they trying to do something different.
Brother Brandon mentioned something just around metrics and the way our churches and denominations are so shaped by market consumer principles. And that's in us. Like, it's not just like out there, those market principles, those ways of understanding whether or not you're doing a good job are in us. And what I've found is that there are moments where you compare the life that you're living, the community that you're forming, to, let's say, the mega church across town. And it just don't add up, right? Don't add up. They got more resources. They got more, you know, they got more drip, they got more clout, all these different things. And those moments are times where we lean into the reality that we're following a revolutionary rabbi that didn't come in on the west side of town with the chariots and Pontius Pilate in them. He came in on the east side of town riding a donkey, demonstrating that the reign of God does not look like the way of empire, that little is much in the hands of God, and that we build with quality and we're not so much consumed about quantity. And so just like do that soul work, confess to your siblings when you're in those spaces of feeling like, is this worth it? Like confess, and in that confession, there's healing and it builds mutuality because the same things are running through the folks that you're doing life with. But be okay with, you know, being different. It's such a simple thing, but just be okay with being different. Just go ahead and make up in your mind, like, I'm no better than any of those folks and I'm always gonna leave the porch light on for everybody. But I'm comfortable in the skin I'm in. I'm comfortable in the tradition that I'm attempting to participate in. And I'm going to be faithful and go on and see what the end will be.
That's good. That's good. We don't want no performative anything. I put in the chat, don't be David trying to put on Saul's armor. It don't fit you. God gave you something that works for you. And it is powerful and it is mighty. So walk in that. It ties into what you were saying, sharing. Be you. Do that, please. Helms and Greg, what would you tell the folks who are trying to do this work?
I think the thing that comes to mind for me is do the smallest thing possible. I think if, like Laura was reading about the eight marks, telling us about the eight marks, and just like, oh, whoa, this is so much to move towards and so much to accomplish and such a big vision. And right now, even like in COVID world, the smallest thing possible, just do that. I mean, Dr. Pinkard, my Lenise said, like yeast, salt, light.
Yeah.
We don't know fireworks needed here. Just the little leaven. And so I think that's the thing I have to remind myself frequently, especially in these moments, is the smallest thing possible. Just do that.
You love to see it. Yes. Those SMART goals, right? Doing things that are attainable, measurable. We are such fans. Greg, do you have anything to add to that?
Yeah, I'm just thinking of, I'm thinking in response about the response of love, but not in the sentimental way, but in the kind of love that Bonhoeffer refers to when he says, when Jesus loves us, he bids us to come and die, right? This is like, this work is not for the faint of heart. You know, it requires courage. And we live in a moment where it seems like it's requiring more and more courage on a daily basis. And so people will do remarkable things when they love one another and when they're deeply connected to one another. And so I just want to, that's, I think that's a really important thing to take along.
Absolutely. It takes courage to love. And if it was easy, everybody would be doing it, jumping on it. So yeah, thank you for that reminder. Karen, I'm gonna ask you, we've heard from your colleagues, what do you want to tell the folks moving forward?
I think two things that came up for me were the balancing, the being intentional with also being open to what happens organically. I think we didn't plan to have a woman autonomous, woman-centered healing group with College Hill, but that's what developed organically. So I think sort of we talk about doing things with intention, and I think I am, you know, proud and happy to say, like, we really do discuss things and reflect and go through that process of discernment, but we also try to be open to what is happening organically. And I think, so sort of balancing that, be ready for conflict. When you talk about being the level of intimacy, when Brandon and Lauren were talking about the risks, there are risks to deep intimacy. Yeah. And so I think being ready for how to handle conflict, you know, I think in our village, in our city village, we had, you know, two members kind of go, we went through a process with them, and we, you know, we allowed them to make the choice that this group wasn't for them. We didn't push anybody out. We didn't, we went through discussion and conflict resolution and communication, a lot of communication, meeting one-on-one and talking through things. And looking back on that, it was a very meaningful, helpful process. And we allowed people to make the choice of what was a good, if we were a good fit for our community. So just be ready for that, and be ready for that emotional labor that it takes, along with the spiritual formation you're going through. So that's probably would be my
that's input. That's so good. They say when iron sharpen iron, sparks fly, y'all. There's gonna be some stuff that pops off. Be ready. But love covers it. Thank you for that. Anthony, brother man, what do you have to say to the folks about what this work requires?
As different people are talking, I'm thinking about, there's a really good book by Adrienne Marie Brown called Emergent Strategy. And one of the things that she talks about is following the energy, right? Let that energy lead you. And for those of us who are in spaces like this, liberative spaces like this, I find myself reminding people who share this kind of heart. There's a scene in the Gospel of Mark, Mark chapter 1. Our community went through an entire year doing a contemplative reading of the entirety of Mark's Gospel. It got tedious. But one of the scenes that stayed with us, and that actually launched our community out 10 years ago, was Jesus' baptismal scene. And in that scene, everybody familiar with that text, is different from the other synoptic gospels in that it does not paint a very rosy picture of how the Spirit intervenes and interrupts this world. It says, as opposed to Matthew and Luke, they say the Spirit opened the heavens. In Mark, it says that the Spirit tore open the heavens. And so one of the things I have to remind people is that we are communities that are being moved by another world, another space, another reality, another presence in the midst of this world, right? And so it goes back to what Greg just said with Dietrich Bonhoeffer, when Christ calls a business, come and die. And so one of the things I've learned is this, is that when the Spirit disrupts, when the Spirit opens up or breaks open in your community, in your space of worship, the way you gather as a community, there becomes a time when very little of the old is left, right? And so I would tell the church, I'm in conversation with many pastors, and they're hoping to survive this. But I'm telling them, no. If you listen to the Spirit in this moment, there should be very little that survives this. Right?
Okay, yeah.
So one of the things that I'm telling people, I said, Jesus is moved by another world. The Spirit descends on him. It gets him crucified by that world, right?
Make it plain.
Because he went right into, in contrast to the structures, the ethos of Roman imperial power, right? So I'm telling people, you really saying you're being led by the Spirit in this season, in this moment, very little is going to survive.
Where are you being led to? Come on. It's the cross.
I would just say keep your discernment on 100 as best as possible. Pray together, prophesy to each other, dance with each other, shout out to each other, fast together. Make sure your discernment is open, because when the Spirit shows up in this manner, especially in the moment in which we're in culturally, I'm telling you right now, people are trying to get out of this thing alive, but you're not. There has to be a death. Because Jesus didn't get out of this thing alive.
is real. That is real. So many folks want to experience resurrection power, but how you get there? You gotta die first. Something has to die. And so thank you for that reminder as we talk about the pain that we encounter, the humility that is required, and sometimes humiliation. There's the work of being humbled, sat down, and take your L, which shouldn't be a loss, it should be a lesson. How do we take those lessons and how do we apply them? That sets up how we move better and can move different. So thank you all. Thank you all for that. I want to see if y'all got anything else to say to us. I don't even have no questions. Just let that spirit talk to you. And what do you have to speak into this moment before, let me one say we're about to go out into breakouts. So you all get to talk a bit more, reflect. We have some questions for you all, but I wanted to see what this panel had to say to us now.
I think I would just like to share that I think in this moment, showing up in our full selves, it's a time that we not only are discerning, but we, like Anthony said, something has to die. And I think that a deep interrogation of who we are and our work to do in this moment together, to think about, you know, what Dr. Cornel West says, justice is what love looks like in public, mm-hmm. That it's just time to dig deep. It's not business as usual. And so when I think about like what our work is to do, it is to show up authentically as who we are. I mean, when I think about the complex layers of my identities as a Black queer woman and faith leader, it is my responsibility in this moment to speak my truth, my story, and amplify the voices of other stories and other people who are living on the margins. I just don't understand how we make it through.
Yeah.
How we make it through this death moment. And so, I mean, that I feel that I just want to offer a word of encouragement for folks who are doing this work to keep on keeping on.
Come on.
Just to keep on keeping on. That is not going to be easy. And we're going to be challenged. It is a risk. We're all working on the margins of our institutions, you know, and on so many levels. For like us here with Good Neighbor Movement, it's not only the margins of our institution, but we're working on the margins of the social justice establishment in our city. We are outliers, and it is what it is. And so we're gonna lean into that. And so using relationships to help lead those deep, intimate relationships, journeying alongside each other, and just showing up 100% who we are, and know that there's a divinity in that, that I believe God is gonna honor in our work. So thank y'all again for the opportunity to be a part of this.
Yeah, Karen, did you have something to share with us?
Yeah, I was going to say what's really stood out to me when I look back at the formation of our city village, I look at the times that we're in, my own life, even in making this cover, I cried. So let the tears flow. Mm. People are dying.
Yeah.
We're mourning loss. It's completely appropriate to be crying. Like, let the tears flow. I'm finding it. I'm crying in my artwork. I'm crying with people. I'm grieving in community. And there's that's important. For me, what seems to have stood out so clearly is this partnership of lamentation to liberation. And that has really, really stood out for me and continues to be something that living, being in the in-between space, honoring the grief, you know, that it's all part of the process. We cried a lot those first, I'd say, few months, the City Village. And I remember even Lauren saying, we would say, oh, I'm sorry, I'm so emotional. And at one point, Lauren just said, can we stop apologizing?
Yeah.
For being emotional, can we stop apologizing for being emotional? So yeah, let the tears flow. Yeah,
yeah, that is so good. And come on, the word says Jesus wept. Even the person who knew that he could raise Lazarus up was sitting there crying and weeping. So yes, allow that that emotion to inform you. Please don't rush through it. I'm glad for the moments that we've taken to pause and to just discern what's coming at us. Take what I call spiritual inventory. What all is there? And don't try and rush through it too quick. You might miss something. Yeah. So I thank you all. I thank you all. This has been so meaningful. Simone, a thumbs up. Are you ready for us for breakouts? So what's going to happen within this breakout space? We have a few questions that I'll be posting into the chat, and also like some folks who are in your room will have. Please make the most of this. We have the reflection, we have the contemplation, but I also want us to be a folk of action. So what are you leaving this weekend with? What are you going to do? That one small thing, as Helms was talking about and referring to, what can you put your hands to and is within your ability with people to start working on? And let's break out into these small mini hush harbor spaces. So I'm finding our questions now, and I want to then Simone is the best. Can we just have a virtual hand clap for Simone? Thank you so much. Ah, godsend. We thank you. You'll see a notification saying you're being whisked away, and you should see that any moment now. We're good to go.
Welcome back, everybody, after you teleported from your small group to this large group session. Hopefully everybody made it back. And if not, then they're in the place they should be. Okay. let's take a moment and do a little larger group reflection. We're going to use the chat box for this and also the screen. So you may choose your options here. I like to give people options for responding. In the chat box, if you want to mention things that stood out to you, words that are coming up, maybe you want to mention the mark that you're going to commit to one small thing related to one specific mark, and put those things in the chat so that we can see them. And as you're putting them in the chat, I'm going to read out some of the things that I see people saying. So maybe your commitment or your one small act or the mark that stood out to you, if you'll place that in the chat. And then for those of you that are like, okay, I'm tired of words and I don't need to type another word or say another word, I'm tired of it, then I think that's appropriate too. So perhaps, as we did earlier on the front porch, we talked about like, where do we sense joy in our body? And not for all time, but just for this moment. Maybe you might place your hand on your eyes. If you're just filled with joy and you just see it from the screen, you might place a hand there. Or maybe you might place them around your ears because you've been hearing such wonderful things and you're delighted in what you're hearing. Or maybe you might place your hand on your heart, because you're just filled with a sense of feeling or life or blood flow. So if words are not how you want to express what's resonating with you, maybe you might place your hand on your body in the place that you're sensing joy unspeakable. And also as you're placing your hand there, maybe you might tap or you might rub or massage that place and kind of bring some energy, some movement to that place, wake it up and say, thank you, body, for giving me this sense of joy that I'm carrying in my body. Sort of move it all down your arms or however you'd like to. And if you're doing that in these moments, I welcome that. I see people writing journeying together and with and in community. I am being open and vulnerable. And am I being open and vulnerable? Have I taken off my mask? Sankofa, what from my spiritual tradition is worthy and capable of decolonization? What happens when we leave the hush arbor? What do we take back to the plantation? How do we exist in those spaces? My, what a question. You might even, in these moments, as we're reading along, you can find the reactions button at the bottom of the screen. And if something speaks out to you that you didn't write, you can put a hand clap or a thumbs up, or you can do that on the screen with your hands. Someone's, Reverend Michelle, you're being seconded in what you said earlier. So there's a hand clap for you. Someone says, all God's children got shoes, trusting that God moves among the collective. Be fully embodied and open to the Holy Spirit's leading. Someone else says, North Star, who are we called to be coming out of the pandemic? How can disruption in our church routines be a portal to be more liberatory church when the pandemic is, quote, over? Take the risk and find and keep community. Decolonizing my bookshelf. Ooh. If someone wants to help Jan decolonize the bookshelf and you have some ideas, put them in the chat. Put your resources in the chat, your playlist in the chat. Why not? And we can all download the chat and read it later. So, or you can, you know, copy and paste and put it in a text document if you want to keep these things for later.
A quick thing, Helms, for the resources, yes, please put them there. But we're also going to create a document, a holding space where you can add those into like a Google document and it would be curated and you can access that post-conference.
Yes. Someone else wrote, we must find truth and let her speak. Yes, joy unspeakable and full of glory. And we've got some suggestions of who to read. Ibram Kendi. Yes, share those books, please, Karen says. So we're taking some moments to talk, to share and express the ways in which the things that we've read and seen have resonated with us. I'm just going to go back up and see if I could figure out what it was that Michelle Ward was being amplify, but I can't find it right this minute. Sophia, wisdom is here. Yes. Liberate God, hashtag. All right, we've got a new hashtag we can use. and so these are the things that we've mentioned in the chat here, but we've talked with our small groups. We have a few more minutes in this large group setting. Is there anybody that wants to unmute and mention something that really stood out to them that someone else said that you heard that you're like, that is something that I really want everyone to hear?
I would love to, Helms, just say one quick thing that came out in our group. Somebody said that, you know, even in our church traditions and our family traditions, you know, it doesn't matter what identities or subjectivities we're coming from. I think that's an important thing for us to remember. There are indigenous gems and jewels that we can bring. And I think it is a work of the spirit for us. Some of it, you know, the stuff is right at the surface, and others of us, we have to dig down and think, what did I get from mama? You know what I'm saying? What did I get from daddy? What did I get from my family of origin? And I think that's an important practice. Because for those of us that are getting older and losing our parents, you know, have lost our grandparents, it's important for us to dig that stuff up, not just from our chosen family, but from our families of origin, churches of origin. There were some good things that we got, or we wouldn't be here and we wouldn't be us.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Anyone else wants to share something that just really you want everyone to hear it? So good. Well, thank you. Thank you, everyone, for sharing. If you raise your hand and I didn't see it, I apologize. You can just unmute yourself. You don't have to wait on me. But I think that I've seen that there's everybody's hearts and minds are good on the sharing part and the expression. Thank you for being willing to share in words and also in the body. Thank you for being able to share in that way. I'm going to pass it over to Brandon.
All right. Thanks for sharing, y'all. I want to ask before I get started, is Camila here? Still here? Camila Sharp? Still in the room?
She had to go to another Rob.
Zoom. Another commitment. Okay, no problem. We were going to ask her to share a little bit more about the gathering, who we'll be worshiping with tonight. And that's what I'm doing, is inviting you to our last piece of the conference. We're going to join in worship with the gathering. We're doing providing opportunities for people to worship with them virtually before the pandemic. And since the pandemic, it has really been a home for a lot of folks across the country, in addition to how they've already been gathering folks virtually before the pandemic. And so, one of the distinctive features of the gathering is an emphasis on womanist preaching. And if you're unfamiliar with womanism, what that is a particular strand of liberation theology that centers the experiences and the truths and the needs and the dreams of Black women as it relates to liberation in this world. And so, listen, they got some preachers. And so I invite y'all to join us this evening. And someone is going to share a link in the chat of how to get on that platform. We're going to be joining them. You can join them on YouTube or Facebook, but we have the Facebook link. And so if someone could drop that link in the chat, but please join us tonight for worship. And again, that is going to be at, let me get my time right. I don't want to tell you the wrong time.
Hey, Simone, could you put up that slide for us, please?
Awesome. Thank you, Simone. And then, sorry. While we're waiting on that slide, no problem. While we're waiting on that slide, and the other piece I want to share is that we want to stay in touch with you. We have, as we've mentioned, a book that's coming out this year. We are curating a resource list that we can distribute to folks. That's gonna come in the form of a Google form. And we're hoping to launch a podcast. Again, this project was funded by the Louisville Institute for us to do research and writing. That phase is done, is complete after the book is launched. And so we are in a creative space again to discern how we move forward. We don't know yet, but we've discussed ideas of a podcast and potentially continuing to have maybe an annual gathering like this. And so we want to stay in touch with you, to hear from you, and to continue to engage with you. And so we invite you to like us on Facebook, Liberating Church, and to keep in touch. And we have your email address from the registration, so we'll be in touch with you. So tonight at 7:00 Eastern Standard Time is when worship begins with the gathering. And you can find them at facebook.com/thegatheringdallas, The Gathering Dallas. And again, going to be sharing more resources over the next few days. I'm super excited about that. And just really want to invite you to continue to stay connected and to share about your experience with someone. In my breakout group, a lot of what came up was that folks really want to, their first step, how they're being called into practice from this experience, is to go talk to some folks, talk to their friends, talk to their comrades, talk to a few people about the experience and begin to reflect on these 8 marks and how they can begin to take that small step. And so share about the experience so we can continue to build and grow as we move forward. And so I want to kick it over to Anthony to close. Well, before that, excuse me, I think that we want to show this book cover again because it's so amazing. And the visual is just beautiful. So we want to show you the book cover again. Just as a way to say again that we want you to be on the lookout for our book. So we want to show that again. Awesome. And thank you again to someone who is very, very dear to me, Karen Archia, for designing this book cover for Liberating Church, a 21st Century Hush Harbor Manifesto. And there's Karen's information to get in touch with Karen. Karen's IG has two there. Reach out. Let's support Black artists and Black women in the dope work that's being done locally and across the country. So yeah, reach out. And I'll kick it over to Anthony.
You're muted, bro.
Thank you. Sorry about that. I should be learning this by now. So I'm going to pray and then just send us out with a proclamation, which will be our benediction around the eight marks. As Jory Bryant, who was in our breakout, he said something very powerful. He said, you cannot hold the spirit, right, in your hand. Like, the spirit can't be held in our hand. Like, you can't hold this. And the thing about that is, which is just simply echoing what Jesus said, you don't know where it's going. And you can only see it by the rustling of the trees, right? And so my prayer is that as you go back to your communities, that you leave yourself open to that kind of wild spirit, right? Always remind, when I think about the Holy Spirit, I think about Nina Simone. She talks about wild is the wind. And if you get a chance to listen to that song, I know it's about love and romance and all that, but I also see it as the movement of the spirit as well. And so if you get a chance, check that song out, very powerful song. Holy and gracious God, we thank you for this time together. Creator, Redeemer, Liberator. We just thank you for just opening up space during this time, these last 2 days. God, as people are sharing their stories, reflecting, listening, leaning in, God, we just pray that there'll be fruit around this, that there'll be a yearning, a stirring for many, and also maybe even a rekindling for many, God. And God, we just pray that you would just grace us to walk into this. To walk into this newness, to walk through the portal that's been talked about today, to walk through this disruption, to be present, to show up with our full selves in this moment in our community, in our context. God, we just pray your spirit would just fill us and even push us into place, to push us into place as those who would bring love where there is none, to be present where there is a lack of presence, to be loved where there is none. And so we just thank you that you will, that as you continually orchestrate your wildness, as you begin to orchestrate your own, our own way to even domesticate you, God, but that God, you are bigger than anything that we could ever imagine, yet you are closer than anything that we can imagine. And Lord, we just thank you for your presence with us during this time. May we continue to learn and listen and keep in contact with each other, God. God, we thank you for these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Here's the proclamation. As all of us, you know, we talked about how some of these communities are leaning into those eight marks more than other marks. And so this proclamation is not necessarily a call to say, you got to be all of these things, but wherever it fits you, that's where it is. And the thing is this, may we stay woke. May we learn to share in the collective pain and learn from the pain of others. May we listen and talk to the talking book. May we learn and listen and watch for how we can be the North Star, a North Star in our community. May we practice wisely with discernment, with open hearts, Sankofa. May you go back and get it and bring it in for a newer generation, for the little ones, for the babies, especially for the babies. May we be communities where all God's children have shoes, got shoes. May you experience joy unspeakable. And as you operate in the margins of, or the critical margins of your community, as you are hidden in plain sight, may you steal away and may you be wise and discerning. May you vet those who need to be properly in the place that you're in. And may we all recognize that we are because we are, that I am because we are Ubuntu. May we practice faithfully, filled with and driven by and pushed by the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Anthony. Amen.
Amen.
Bless y'all. Bless y'all. Hey, and it, you know, we did a kind of, like last night, a kind of after party-ish, just sort of hang out saying hey to one another. If you got to go, we totally get it. You can leave. But if you want to just sort of stay on and linger on the front porch, or, you know, if you grew up in a small church like mine, we call it the vestibule. If you want to linger in the vestibule, you can linger in the vestibule. That's what we're doing right now. So yeah, if you got to go, we totally get it. But for those that want to linger and just say hello and continue in conversation, we welcome you to do that. I'm going to facilitate. It'll be very informal, very informal. Peace, y'all. Peace, peace. Join us tonight for those that have to go.
Just sending out love to everybody. It's so good to see you, Carol. Good to see you, Nicola, folks from back home. Anthony, beautiful. Simone, thank you for tech. Venetia, thank you. Terrence, thank you. All of the folks at Helms, everybody that had something to do with this. So good to see everybody.
Yeah. Thank you. You've been a gem. We thank you so much for pouring into us and into this project. I even remember when this project kicked off, you were one of the very first people that I heard from. So this is full circle to still be ministered to by you. So this has been a gift and a joy. Thank you so much.
That's right. You were still in Oakland. You called in. Do you remember
mm-hmm,
that?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, y'all. When will the recording of last night's talk be available? You know, soon and very soon. We don't have dates, but soon. Keep watch.
Come keep on, watch. Stay in the wake.
Stay in the wake.
Now you can replay it on the Facebook.
Oh, Facebook. That's right. You can go to Facebook right now and replay it. That's right. Good point. That's right.
Who wasn't on this call who said be excellent and be well? But if you have to choose, be well.
It was Camila. Yeah.
But it was a quote from Chelsea Yarborough. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Looks like some folks are joining us in the room that weren't able to make that so funny. Oh, gosh. I love it. I love it. The internet is something, y'all.
You know, it makes me think about, you know, we out here, we got the spirituals, they send in messages, and sometimes you just get your Eastern and Central and all that confused. You was in the right place, baby, but got there kind of late. Gotta wait for the next train to come on the ground. It's all right. It's all right.
That's right. That's right. That's right.
They can watch the recording, right?
Yeah, yes. Sure. So anyone who was registered, even if they weren't able to be here with us, I do plan on via Eventbrite making through that email list, making the recordings available.
Oh, I have to give a shout out to because they won't do this. Brandon and Lauren, my G&M colleagues, mm-hmm. who are my friends, my comrades, my spiritual brothers and sis, brother and sister. Mm-hmm. My advisors, my confidants, mm-hmm. they do something called Sacred Pause on our Facebook Live page at 9 a.m. each Monday morning. And it's something new. They've done three so far. Mm-hmm. And I have found it's just a great way to start the week because they talk about, this is something they do. You know, Lauren works with Good Neighbor Movement. And Brandon is our founding pastor. So they talk all the time. So they just kind of brought some of that conversation online and just what they're struggling with, what they're thinking about, what they're feeling, what's going on in their lives and taking a pause for us. Lauren brings her gift of song and, you know, brings it in and sometimes closes it with a hymn or some music. It's just real and down to earth. And so if you miss it at 9 a.m., it's posted. It's hosted, they are on Zoom, but then it's posted on Facebook, Facebook Live, yep, at the Good Neighbor Movement site. And then, but if you miss it, it's posted after it's finished, so you could come anytime, yeah, and have a sacred pause,
yeah,
and listen, yeah, to them. So just, yeah, want to give them a shout out for thank doing you, that Karen, sharing and that you know, prayer and reflection time and offering it.
Thank you, Karen. That's beautiful. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I found our small group that we had, our breakout room, was so sweet. And it was intergenerational. It was so beautiful. And I feel like this, I wasn't able to see everybody on the screen, but I felt like it was a beautiful reflection of what our ancestors' wildest dreams, right? And so yeah, I feel like there's a lot of resonance around taking that small step. That's so important. Taking that small step and doing it with people. Not just getting stuck in your own head or stuck in your own heart. Yeah. Being willing to share it with some folks, test it out. That's risky because, you know, it's going to change whatever idea you have or what you're sort of pondering on. But yeah, when we're walking together with it, it's better. So I just found that to be super, like if that's the takeaway from one of the strong takeaways from this, is for folks to enter into conversation about ways they implement one of the marks, or just their experience here, like what something, a burning, a yearning they've had. That's powerful. That's where it starts. That kind of a spark. So, yeah.
Brandon,
go ahead.
I wanted to just say two things that came to me. One, you know, that scripture where the, some folks show up and they, well, it's actually, it's Jesus's family, his birth family, family of origin. And somebody, one of the disciples come and they say, you know, your mom and them, they out there on the porch looking for you. And he said, just hold on a minute. And he's doing something. He's praying with somebody. You're talking about something, teaching something. And when he gets done, he goes out on the porch and he says, who is my mother? Who is my father? Who is my sister? Who is my brother? Those that do the will of God.
That's right.
And so I just have to shout out for Chosen Family. Oh, my mm-hmm. Lord, you know, and to be amongst people that are hungry and yearning. I just can't tell you what I'm getting from you. I said, Lord, don't drop a tambourine. Lord, I will tear up my house. If somebody just drop a tambourine accidentally, I will
tear accidentally, if you accidentally.
Y'all talking about good Pentecostal folk? I was
that's like, what I'm talking about, baby. I will tear it up.
Listen. My, you know, my, if you would have heard my chimes going off.
It's a cell phone ring.
Exactly. It's like, Lord Jesus. And then the one last thing I wanted to share is that I wish I had said this in the big group last night, but just really briefly, there's a point in Beloved, a place in Beloved where Toni Morrison has Paul D. I mean, Setha says to Paul D. She says, talk about Beloved. She says, she my best thing. And Paul D. say, no, you your best thing. And I love that my folks at home know that I love to say this, just you standing naked in a field of tulips, more precious than a diamond, you your best thing. And that goes back to wellness, Karen, you know, what you were lifting up, the quote, you know, let's be well, let's love each other and let's love ourselves. Because God can do anything, you know what I'm saying? God made us, let's love ourselves.
That's right.
Brandon said on Sacred Pause last week, something, he said, because all this virtual stuff, you know, have to remind, I'm not a virtual person. Like we're not virtual people. We're real virtual. Mm-hmm. We're real people. And this is just, you know, a channel or a method to connect. But I needed to hear that because mm-hmm. it's like, yes, I'm communicating this way, but I'm still a real person.
Yeah.
Yeah. Woo.
Mm-hmm. I want to just shout out again, Karen. It's Karen's artistic genius. I know we've done it three times now, but listen, you just like, listen, when you behold something that's beautiful, you just got to keep talking about it, right? So
let me tell you how Karen has an interpretation of tongues. Because let me tell you, I was just like, I think that should be over there and maybe move it over. I see Martin when I look at it, but not really, some 70s text and just saying things. And she was like, I don't think that's what you mean, but let's talk about it some more. Yes. And the real pastoral work of bringing like what's in somebody's heart and in their mind and making it a reality, that is such a work of shepherding, even within your art. So seriously, when we tell you that it is beautiful, it is not just the visual thing, but the process that you've created glorious. Thank you.
Well, and V, let me say thank you to you, because you brought something. Like, I have an artistic voice, and I feel like if you're like, okay, we're hiring you for that, but it's not just about me, it's your book. So I wanted the cover to speak to what you wanted to speak to. And that was a process of discussion, and that's why I put the review and revise sessions in, because that can kind of take some time. Mm-hmm. But you brought something that when I finished the cover, the whole is greater than the sum of the parts. Like, I have an eye for order, and you brought this beautiful like movement dynamism, to the words that I took and refined a little. But I needed you to do that. Like, that's not something that the way the letters are laid out is not something I came up with on my own. I was listening to you and figuring out what you were saying and reflecting things to you. And then I took that back to finish it out and, kind of take what you had offered and shown me and just like, create relationships with the letters. There are some letters that are anchors in the text. So you brought something to that process too that I would not have just done on my own. And so I appreciate that. I will work with you anytime, I think, creative. Because I think we have complementary creative voices.
Let's do it again. When's the next book, Brandon?
So it's great. Listen. Fantastic. Fantastic listen. Process.
And let me say about the book, I want to say something to us that was that, again, we've had a lot of elders that have journeyed with us through this project. Some of them haven't been able to stay with us for one reason or another. But like we, even the sort of, who I call the sort of the genius of the Hush Harpers, Dr. Albert Rabiteau, who wrote the sort of classical text on the Hush Harpers. And like, you need to read that if you want to learn about the Hush Harpers. And
what's that book again, Brandon?
The name, I always mess up.
Will you put it in the chat?
Yeah, we'll put it in the chat. Can somebody look that up while we're talking? Somebody look up the title and drop it in the chat.
Slave religion,
that's right. Yep. And, we had him, we had Dr. Stephen Ray, we had Reverend Lanice, we had some other folks. Dr. Stephen Ray is the president of, I think, Chicago Theological Seminary. And one of the things that he said to us that was really, really powerful, and through all the ups and downs and ebbs and flows of this project, it stayed with me. He said, y'all don't neglect to write. Mm. Write it down. Mm. You don't write it down, it's going to be hard to carry it forward in this age. Mm. Look how hard it's been for us to be able to retrieve and reclaim the words of the Hush Harpers from just the little bit that we have from the sort of written record of interviews with enslaved Africans, and then of course the spirituals, right? It's been mainly oral. Mm-hmm. And there's nothing wrong with oral. We will continue to do the oral work. But he said, I need you to write. And there were times in this project that, like, frankly, y'all, like, we didn't have the energy or strength. None of us are being, at that time, we're being paid to do this work. We were all doing it as volunteers. We are all on the ground, grassroots, clergy activists, leading churches, some of us working other jobs. Like, it's so, like, we didn't, but that call to write what we've been doing has been important. And so I want to just raise this to say that it's not just about what we're doing, it's about what you're doing. Take the time and don't feel like you got to do it by yourself. The power of what we've done is we've all written. We have a collective. And here's the deal. Even the way we're self-publishing this book, because we've had a lot of publishers reach out, and we support going with publishing houses. But in order to do it our way, we needed to refuse those opportunities for this particular work. given our needs and our capacity right now. So write. Make sure you're writing. And writing is not just, I mean, I want to say that it's not just about prose, and it's also about our art as well. So it's in whatever way you can document the work that you're doing is so important. So that, and that's what is critical about being a hush harbor, is that it's not about the preacher class or the clergy class. Uh-huh. It's not about the educated class. It's about disseminating the information and letting the Spirit use it to build up the power of the people in local places. And it goes way beyond what you can imagine, I think, when you first get it in your head. And so thank you for bringing up the writing. We're going to write more, and all of us need to be writing.
Mm-hmm. We got to tell the story of how we got over.
Right.
So I am so excited to be doing this. Even think about if you journal, if you were to look back at a journal from 2-3 years ago, just to see the transformation. We want to be able to look back and see all that God has done. So thank y'all for making this possible. But yes, we are not the experts. We are just the people that the Spirit has chosen to push into this, but within your spheres. For sure. Mm-hmm. Begin to write, sing, dance.
That's right.
Record it, do it, and let somebody see it.
Yeah.
And right. I'll just chime in. I'll chime in for a second about this writing thing. I don't know how many of you are clergy leading churches or faith communities. If when you hear the word write, you immediately thought, yeah, I can do a sermon series on this. That's not exactly, but it's hard to think about writing in a way that's not so completely embedded with capitalist impulse on how you can profit or how you can get the most bandwidth or whatever out of those words. Consider, that's where art is so important, but consider writing that is more for your own, learning to love your flesh and understand your flesh, right? It is for others too, but this doesn't translate directly into a sermon series.
That's right.
It doesn't translate into something that can be or should be capitalized upon, especially when it's your own reflection. I know as clergy myself that impulse comes pretty quickly, like, oh, thank God, I'm so tired, and maybe this gives me something I can latch onto, and I can get 6 weeks out of this material, or 8 weeks, and just saying, like, recognize that impulse is perhaps more formed by a capitalist performativity than it is by the Spirit who wants you to rest and to be and to love yourself. Flesh. Mm-hmm. So just saying that.
Yeah, that's powerful. Thank you, Whitney. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, there's the bit. Thanks for showing the little one, Alex. Yeah. Hey there.
Hi, friend.
Hi. Hey there. Cool.
So I love seeing the little folks on the Zoom calls. Mm-hmm. Hey.
Also, I want to give a shout out to Simone. Simone Williams. She was the newest member of our team. And the youngest member of our team, if I'm not mistaken, right?
Actually, I don't know how old you are, Simone. We ain't gonna put you on blast, but I really don't know how old you are, actually.
Yeah. But I'm sorry, Glenn.
Oh no, I was just gonna say thank you. Sorry, I didn't interrupt you.
Oh. No, just she's brilliant. As you can tell, she's a woman of a few words, but I think she got a lot of words, but the way she's just kind of come onto our team and been very powerfully, very helpful with a lot of behind the scenes work around research, around the tech, around many different things. And so I just want to lift her up. One of the things we try to practice in our communities is really try to center and lift up younger people in our community, because they're going to be the ones that are going to carry the story forward. And so I just want to lift you up, Simone. Thank you so much.
Thank y'all for bringing me on to the team. It's been wonderful to watch all of y'all's hard work come together especially for this event. So it's been really nice to just be a part of the team and learn from y'all, and be a part of everything that each of you individually bring to the team. It's been really nice. So thank you and congrats on this conference. Yeah.
Since we're giving shout outs, I want to give some shout outs to late nights of transcribing interviews. I ain't gonna name names, but you know who you are. I'm one of them. Late nights of writing articles, late nights of editing articles. You know, bless your soul. Listen, it is a labor of love. You know, yeah. All the mining. So here's something funny. It's a funny piece. Since we've been working on the book, one of the things that we've had to really draw out are quotes from original sources from the Hush Harbors, right? It's important to hear our voices, but we really want to lift up the voices of enslaved Africans as much as we can. And so like at the beginning of the project, one of the things that we curate, one of the pieces that was curated was a kind of worksheet to kind of work through our lit review. And if it wasn't for Helms and Laura, we wouldn't have a lot of these quotes. I'm just gonna keep it a buck with y'all. Like they were the only three folks that went in and wrote down quotes from African, enslaved Africans' lips, not talking about what they said, but what they said. And bless y'all, like we wouldn't have those quotes. That is critical. And as I've been going back through doing the editing work for the book, like Simone and I have had to like draw from that, because otherwise we wouldn't have it. And especially in COVID, when I can't get to a library to go, you know, double back down and kind of find it. So bless y'all for that. That's huge. So yeah.
You know, we got to give a shout out to Brandon. He shared with me the email that he sent to kind of get this thing going. And it is an incredible labor of love and vision and ridiculous amount of energy. None of this would have happened without Brandon. So we got to give him big props.
Yeah. Thank you, Whitney. I appreciate that. Yeah. Yeah.
I just put in the chat, we adore you.
Hey, bless y'all. Listen, I'm just trying to, when I feel it, I try to share it. That's all. Feel it, I try to share it. And yeah, these folks have been my lifeline. I mean, if it wasn't for Helms and Greg and Anthony and Terrence and Lot, like I could go, listen, my family would be struggling. So, you know, these institutions they aren't our people. I just talk to my folks. That's how I look at it. I look at it like, yeah, I just shared an idea with my people. What y'all think? If y'all should read the email I sent it to Whitney, it's like, it's pretty raggedy. It's raggedy as fuck, to be honest with you. but it's me though. And they knew it. Like, listen, they texted back. This is great. Let's get on the phone. Don't write no more long ass emails. You know, So yeah, that's it. And we got denied. We got rejected a lot. Like Louisville didn't originally the project was supposed to be for the base communities and the Hush Harbors. We were gonna do research on both of those traditions. And we were applying for a bigger grant and we were denied. And we went ahead and kept moving with the work without money, we still don't got a huge following. Like this isn't sexy stuff. So yeah, it's about the integrity, and these folks are people of integrity, and I'm trying to be that too. So yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm gonna say good late afternoon to everybody. My turtle T. Morrison is getting, there's somebody outside helping us to build her a little thing so she can be outside, because she's a woods turtle. So we're going to have her, but she's going to be in a little space. So that's being built. And you all say blessings for T. Morrison. She's getting adjusted. I love y'all, and I'll see you on the call tonight. Thank you so much. So much.
Thank you. See you later.
All right, y'all. I'm going to hop off too. And let's worship the night with the gathering. I can't wait to be with them. And so I hope y'all are able to join us tonight.
Peace congrats out. On this book. Have a mm-hmm. good evening.
Yeah, congratulations. You did it.
Yeah. Thank you so much.